everybody, it's Zazu Siosi, physical therapist here, and we are going to talk a little bit about some things that you can do about pain, especially things that you can refer to on your own, especially now during this time where we are trying to stay at home and a lot of us do not necessarily want to go to the physician's office or another, you know, medical provider's office if we don't necessarily have to. So this is going to be just giving you some resources to be able to use while you're at home if you're experiencing pain. As always, you can always reach out to me with any questions and I will help in whatever way that I can, but these tools are tools that I oftentimes will give my clients who are dealing with pain. So the first tool is called the protectometer. So this is a handbook for basically explaining in very simple and brief. I mean, it's a very thin book and a lot of that is some post-it notes that are here. In basically how the body works with pain. And in our last video, we talked about pain on the brain and how the brain makes pain in relation to the context that we're in. And if it is taking on more danger signals that we may be in danger and we need to do something to protect ourselves versus safety around us. Because if we are safe in a certain environment, then it doesn't need to protect us and we don't need to do anything to protect ourselves. So it's like when we're lying in bed, we're in one of the safest places that we can be. And so that is a place where a lot of times people feel okay and they feel good. But sometimes I hear actually a good amount of my clients say, oh, when I lay in bed at the end of the day, I really feel it in my back, or I really feel it in whatever other body part. And you have to think, you know, if it was just the musculoskeletal system, if it was just the muscles, then why would you be in pain when you're completely supported and you're resting and you're not doing anything hard? And so again, that's where the pain created by the brain comes in. And so this is a really great resource to be able to kind of walk through some really basic information on how it is created, maybe why it's happening to you, and what maybe your context is, but then allowing you to kind of take the reins yourself and really dive in and see, okay, what is really affecting my pain? What are the dangers around me that my body is perceiving that is making it create pain? And a lot of times pain that persists, and a lot of times pain that, you know, you shouldn't have. Like the example where you're resting but you're in pain. So another example of, you know, where you shouldn't have pain is people who have amputations a lot of times will have something called phantom limb pain. And so literally, you know, their foot is gone, it's been amputated, and yet they are having pain in a body part that's no longer there. So we know that that body part isn't what's creating that pain because it's literally not there. It's coming from the brain and the maps that are in the brain that map out all of our body parts and our sensations of those body parts. So one key thing that I want to outline here in this book is that there is an exercise, which I really think is like the biggest money in this book, bang for your buck, is going to be, it's called DIMS and SIMS. So let me find the picture here of it. And it is basically going to walk you through how to assess all of the different types of situations, contexts, you know, maybe the like actual body part that's causing some issues, but also our beliefs, our language that we hear, you know, about ourselves, like you have degeneration in your spine, or you know, you have bone spurs, you know, one place or another. So how the type of language that is used with you, so whether that be by your provider or whether that be how you see yourself, how that affects your pain and how that plays into, we call it in this book, the dangers in me versus the safety in me. And that's where the dims and the sims come up. And so this is basically a nice big graph where you are basically going to put, you know, the name and, well, not really, I mean, it's yours. You can put your name if you want to, but you don't have to. The date, and you're going to rate your pain and where you feel your pain. And then you're going to, whatever, put yourself, put that post-it anywhere along this middle line here. And then if you're not in any pain, then you would put yourself here, because a lot of times we have pain one day, but then we don't have any pain another day. And what I find with a lot of my clients who have pain for a long time is that they can't put a finger on what's the difference between one day or another. And that is definitely a big flag that your brain has something to do with it. Now, you definitely, you know, want to get a medical screen to screen any other possibilities for what may be going on in that area. But I generally tend to see patients or clients who have gone through all the testing, have gone through testing multiple times over the years, and there's nothing that comes up that really should be creating the amount and severity and intensity of the pain that they have. And that's when we go, okay, our system is really out of whack and we need to bring it back in balance. And part of bringing it back in balance is taking in the entire picture and not just the body part picture. Because again, pain comes from the brain. So we've got to go to the source and not just to the part of the body that hurts. Otherwise, you're only going to get, you know, a little bit of relief for a small period of time, and it's not going to be anything that lasts, you know, and that's what you want. You want it to go away forever. And we talked last time as well about how pain is something that we all experience in our life at one point or another, and but there is a process that our body should go through. Pain has a purpose in a very acute setting or situation or context to try to save us from whatever danger is around us. So whether that be, you know, like a fire ant biting us and, you know, that needs to bring our attention to the fire ant or to that area so that we can get it off of us, or whether that be, you know, any other type of injury where our brain is saying, hey, you're in danger, you need to pay attention to this, and you need to do something about it. But then again, we know that healing happens over a certain time period, so once that time period is done, well then, why is there still pain? And so again, we've got to bring in balance our system that has basically become very good at creating pain when pain isn't needed anymore, because things are healed as good as they're going to be, and it's time to move on and be able to live your life without pain. So back to this. So you've got different color sticky notes for different areas of, you know, thoughts, beliefs. I'll read some. So places you go. So for an example, a danger in me might be, you know, if I have back pain, but I have back pain after a car accident that I had. Every time I drive by the place where I had the accident, that could be a danger in me or a signal to your brain or to your system. You know, you get a little anxiety or you get a little stressed, just remembering everything that you went through. So that would be considered something that would be a danger in me or a danger signal to your system that would basically ramp up any pain that you've got. So a, you know, on the opposite side would be a SIM. So a safety in me. So a safety in me for a place that you would go. Maybe it's going to your mom's house and you feel safe there. You grew up there. You still have your childhood bedroom the way it's set up. You have great memories there. And it's a place where you feel good, you feel supported, and you feel safe. So those are just two examples of how, you know, places you go could be used as either a danger signal to your body of, hey, we've been here before and something bad happened, you need to watch out here, again, creating pain, or the other, which is the safety in me, which is, hey, we're okay here. Every time we've been here, we've been taken care of, and that's what we can expect this time too. So it goes a lot based off of your past experiences. And we know that our past experiences also shape our beliefs and our thoughts. So there's a good amount of research actually to show, you know, mindset and gratitude specifically, and having a positive attitude actually helps people heal better, faster. Actually helps decrease pain in people who have those types of attitudes or mindsets compared to people who are maybe a little bit more in a negative place, have negative thoughts, are not grateful for what, you know, for anything, basically. And so there's research out there to show that. So how would gratitude have anything to do with your pain level? But yet there's research out there that shows that it does. So again, how does that reinforce that the brain has a really large role in how we experience pain? So this is just one, you know, really great resource. I recommend it highly. There are some other resources out there. I really like this one because it is really set up like a handbook. So, you know, and it really doesn't take long to go through. And it basically empowers you to take your pain into your own hands. Because at the end of the day, you can go see whoever you want, but it's your body, and therefore you have the ability to help yourself. And so that in and of itself is great for healing pretty much anything, regardless of where you are, you know, with pain. So, or what type of injury that you have. So again, this is the Explain Pain Handbook, the Protectometer, and it is written by Lorimer Mosley and David Butler. So you can kind of see the picture of it, but there are their names or their initials. And it is a really, really great handbook. If you know someone in pain, this is a really great gift. And hopefully they get a lot out of it. But you definitely have to be ready to start to take some ownership of that pain and start to take your life kind of back into your hands. Obviously with the guidance of, you know, providers or professionals, and again, if anybody wants to reach out, like, I'm very happy to speak with you. But at the end of the day, the only person responsible for your healing is you, and everyone who's there to help you is there to guide you through it and walk you, you know, walk with you during your journey and not do your journey for you. And this is a really great way to kind of take the first step to taking leadership in your own healing journey. And just make sure you've got a great team around you that is going to walk with you. So that was your movement minute. We didn't move a lot, but I hope we learned a little bit. And again, reach out if you guys have any questions, and I hope you guys are well.